Savior and soon coming King. Amen.
Amen.
Ready?
Yeah. Thank you. take just a moment to thank everyone for your cards, your phone calls, your texts. But more importantly, thank you for your prayers for my recent illness. I had sepsis infection. I didn't realize until I got it, but it can be fatal. It took me about 6 weeks to get over it. That's why I wasn't in church. But anyway, I praise the Lord that I've got my strength back now and I'm better. And of course, now I've got to deal with another issue, the cancer. But thanks, and I prayed before we went to the doctor and told him whatever the diagnosis was, that the Lord would give his glory and he would be edified. And I'm believing that's going to be the case.
Amen.
God's going to get the glory from it.
Amen.
Of course, nobody wants to go in the doctor's office and hear the C word.
That's right.
Again, I have my trust and my faith in him. I go see a specialist at the Baptist Hospital November 22nd, so I appreciate your prayers between now and then. He may tell me the cancer's gone.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Peace with your world is happening.
We'll give God another praise for the music. You know, Sister Mary said that, you know, we need to sing out to God. But you know what? Sometimes Jesus needs to sing over us. And that's what he's been doing all week long. In fact, for the last 3 weeks, he's just been singing a song over me and my wife. Because the last 3 weeks, I've been working 11 to 14 hour days. And I don't want you to think that, oh, look at what he does. No, no, no. It's by his glory and praise for him that I'm able to do all that.
Amen.
Amen.
Because I'm not smart enough, don't have the strength, don't have what it takes. But because he's in my life, the last 3 weeks, he's been singing over my life. And I don't know how many of you know that I'm a supervisor where I work. I have anywhere from 17 to 26 people that I supervise. And trying to, in such, because, well, let me just back up a little bit. Where I work, we're one of the biggest suppliers of the flu vaccine. And it's just been a chaotic 3 weeks. Everybody wants their flu yesterday. And trying to keep the orders going out the door with supply, you know, because of, in today's world, you know, our supplies are going up in cost. People don't want to work. We had a couple of temporaries. They worked a day and a half, and they said, can't do it, we're out. So that's what I've been dealing with. But you know what? Throughout those 3 weeks, this has been coming to me. Love God. Love peace. And because of those two, you gotta love people. Even the ones you don't like. And I'm not saying I don't like anybody, because God tells me to love everyone. But there's certain behaviors and attitudes that can be frowned on a time or two. But he's just speaking, you know. And last Sunday I got to teach Sunday school, and that message, you know, it tells us we have to be an example to people. We have to show them there is a real reason for being here this morning. There is a real reason to believe in Jesus Christ. There is a, you know, and regardless of what he blesses us with, even if he was to not bless me ever again, Charles, I can consider myself blessed and highly favored.
Amen.
See, we're going to be the light of the world. In this world, we've got to be a lighthouse to the world. We've got to be showing people that there is an answer for all this chaos and randomness,
right,
and all, amen, of this stuff that's going on in this world.
Amen.
And just like the Sunday school said, lesson said, we have to be the salt. We've got to create a thirst for people to be coming in here and want to know this God that we know and to be one of his children. That right there is the ultimate blessing, I believe. To be one of His, to know that just like all these songs that we sung, everything that we sung about, we get to claim. We get to hold on to that solid rock. We get to have that anchor in this chaotic and turbulent world. It's nice to know that I can say, thank you, Lord.
Amen.
Thank you. Because all of us are looking for acceptance. You know, we want it from our family. We want it from our friends. We want it from our coworkers. And we're looking for a purpose. And if we're looking for a purpose that God has destined us for, how much more are these people out here in this world that don't have the hope that we have, that need that hope and that purpose?
That's right.
The world wants it. The world needs it. But they just don't know how to get it.
Yeah.
That's why we need to be the peacemakers. And I know that, you know, these Beatitudes, they're the characteristics a Christian should have. But this one here, it just spoke to me this week, these last 3 weeks. And that's Matthew chapter 5, verse 9. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called sons of God. You know, sometimes I wonder, you know, when we read this word, if God's not asking us to flip it around, you know, and if we are His children, why aren't we peacemakers? The Bible is about application, putting meaning into our lives, showing us what we need to do and how we need to do it. We need to be peacemakers. There's a lot of people out there that don't have the peace that we have. We need to be sharing it. We need to be saying, hey, this is what I have. Just because I believe in God's Son, Jesus Christ, I have that peace. I don't have to worry about the virus. I don't have to worry about whether or not vaccines happen in the world. I don't have to worry about whether the people that are in positions of power above us, what decision they make, because I have the ultimate answer. I have the ultimate answer.
That's right.
Whether it's Trump, whether it's Biden, whether it's Kamala Harris, whether it's Pelosi, it doesn't matter, because I have Him. He claims me as one of His own. And because He claims me, because the Holy Spirit lives in my life, I need, you know, I'm not trying to earn my salvation, Charles. But because of the love that we sang about, I want to do what I can for His kingdom. I want to do what He asked me to do. I want to be obedient to that pull and that tugging of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
See, we need to show the world a better way. And in Genesis chapter 13, verses 8 and 9, I went old school on this one. Let me find it. I have them all marked. But this is where Abram, you know, him and his nephew Lot were arguing, their herdsmen were arguing. And it says, is not the whole land before you? Please separate from me. If you take the left, then I will go right. Or, if you go right, I will go left. See, that's the thing. See, Abram knew in order to count, to not have strife in his life, he needed to find a peaceable way of doing this.
Yes.
And that's what we need to do. We, you know, you see the things that are happening. You know, they want to defund the police, and you know, I'm sorry, I'm not trying to be political, but I'm just trying to point out things that are happening in the world that, with us as the church, the body of Jesus Christ, there's some things that we can do about it. And Abram, he said, okay, don't want any more argument between your people and my people. You go this way, and if you don't want that way, take that way. And that's what we need to do. We need to find solutions. We need to jump in the middle of the fight and say, hey, what's this going to serve? See, because this world is so troubled because of the open sin that's in it. People are trying to legislate morality, but it's not about being morally right. It's about being sinless. Even though our human condition, that's impossible to do if we're doing it on our own. That's why we need Jesus Christ. Amen. That's why we need the leading and the guiding of the Holy Spirit. And I know most of you know this, but it doesn't hurt repeating. This is a good word. It's meant to get us from the time that we first accept salvation, just like the song said. The longer we serve Him, the sweeter He grows.
Yeah, that's right.
Isn't that the case? I mean, you ask anybody in here, and I mean, guess not everything, but He said, if they hated me, they're going to hate you. And if I have trials and temptations in my life, how much more are we going to? But you know what? He's there. He's there to be with us. I want to do something not normally done. I want all of you to close your eyes and just say, Jesus. How comforting is that name? I mean, just by mentioning His name, Charles, things that we worry about out there in this world, they just kind of slide off of our back when we turn our focus to Him. See, because in this world, there's a lot of things going on. Some things that we condone, see, that's the thing, is as a church, there should be absolutely no compromise on sin. You know, as humans, we tend to label. Oh, that's just a little white lie. Oh, it's not like I'm killing anybody. And see, that's where we go wrong from the beginning. Because to God, sin is sin. In fact, in Isaiah 48:22, He said, there is no peace, says the Lord, for the wicked. What a desperate situation. I mean, because we do fall into trials and temptations, and we do kind of slip and stumble every once in a while. But all we have to do is ask for forgiveness. What peace does the wicked have? They don't have that ability. unless we're showing them that, hey, this is the answer for our fallen condition. This is how we get by. Do we deserve it? No, but we get it anyway because God is who He is. He's much better than we can ever think of. In fact, if we could figure out God, God wouldn't be God, would He, Pastor Mike?
That's right.
And that's the thing, is we're His children. And as His children, we should be looking up to our friend and Savior Jesus Christ. He's the example. He showed us a better way to live. And I mean, there's a lot of people that debate, oh, did God create man or did man create God? Well, I truly believe, like the Bible says, God created us. But you know what? On the flip side of that, even if there is no such thing as God, isn't it a much better way to live? And that's what, I mean, we've got to be thoughtful about this. We've got to be mindful, just like Jesus told Mary and Joseph, I've got to be about my Father's business. And for His children, shouldn't we be mindful of our Father's business? Shouldn't we be sharing our testimony? Shouldn't we be praying for people? It's like Brother Jack says, that's our greatest weapon. And the thing about that is, all you have to do is pray. He's the one that's responsible for answering it. God is the one that puts the power behind the prayer. So that's what we need to do. We need to be prayerful about that. You know, we don't like the condition of our country, pray. We don't like the condition of the world, pray. We don't like the condition of our families, pray. We're having illness or whatever, pray. It's the answer. It's what He's given to us. He's given it to us for a reason. And here's the thing. You know, we don't need to be all high and mighty about it. But this is, in Psalm 34, verse 14, this is what we need to be telling people. Depart from evil and do good. I mean, it's so easy. We have to seek peace and pursue it. See, that word pursue, that's an action word. That's a verb. That means you've got to do something about it. It's not just going to fall in your lap. You have to pursue it. And just like the earlier part of the verse, do good. You know, if you're out here raising Cain, raising, you know, not doing what you're supposed to be doing, that's part of the problem. But us, as His children, need to be doing good. Showing people that there is a different way to act. That there is a different way to be. A different way to believe. Seek peace and pursue it. That's what we got to be. He said, blessed are the peacemakers. So right there, that's a promise to you. If you're seeking peace, if you're making peace with your brothers and sisters, co-workers, whoever, somebody at Walmart is giving the, you know, there was an instance, I want to give a quick illustration. Back when the first shut down the, you know, where they were telling everybody to quarantine, me and Christy went into Walmart, and that's when they had the aisles marked. You go this way, you don't go that way, you go this way, and it just snaked throughout Walmart. Little old lady, just trying to get into the aisle. She was going the wrong way. And, you know, I did my best to get out of her way. You know, I told Christy, I said, scoot your buggy over. And there was a gentleman that was coming the right way. He looked at her, looked down, threw his can of vegetables into his buggy. And I don't know if the little old lady sinned or not, but he pointed at that sign. Like, hey lady, you're going the wrong way. You're doing things wrong. What did it hurt that she was going the wrong way? But see, that's the thing, is because there are gentlemen out there like that, that, you know, yes, it's nice to be mindful of other people, but you know what? That little old lady was just trying to get her can of vegetables like he was. And I just said, Lord, help him. You know, move in his life that he doesn't have to act that way. Move in his life that, and here's the thing, as his children, we want forgiveness, right? But are we giving forgiveness as much as we're wanting it for ourselves? See, I stepped on my own toes there, because I know that as much as I want to be saved from hell, as much as I want to enjoy communion in heaven with God and Jesus and the Holy Spirit, I can't act any way but how he acts. Because that's what he's wanting. Like I said, we've got to be a light. We've got to be peacemakers. And see, and all throughout the Bible, he says, if you just make me your focus, all these things that are out there in the world, people stepping on each other to get to the next level in their job, or to the next biggest house, or the next, you know, we were talking about cars in the vestibule this morning. $106,000 Mustang? I mean, come on. You give me one that's, you know, beat up, I'll be happy with that. I don't need $106,000 Mustang. But I do need him.
That's fine. Amen.
See, we need to seek peace, not only in this world, but we need to be telling people, make peace with yourself. Make peace with each other. And make peace ultimately with God. See, because somebody can come in here, and, you know, you've seen the church shootings and, you know, shootings at work and schools and stuff like that. They could shoot any one of us, but we know where we're going. Those people out there, they don't have that peace and they don't have that assurance. And it's time, you know, and I'm speaking to myself when I say this, it's time that the church take its spot where it's supposed to be.
Yep. Amen.
Mm-hmm.
We're supposed to be out there. You know, it's nice to sit on these comfortable pews and stuff like that, but you know what? When God moves us out of our comfort zone, we can't think, oh, well, I can't do it. And I'm saying, I can't do it. No, God's going to be there to supply your every need. Just like when we went to the bridge, there was that gentleman, big, tall gentleman, and he was like, you know, we didn't have a 2X or a 3X, what he wanted. And I'm not saying this, but both me and Charlie B, we took off our own hoodies. Here, take this. Because that's what we got to do. We got to show them that God loves them just as much as he does his children. See, because while yet Jesus was hanging on the cross, he was making peace between us and God the Father. Mm-hmm.
Yep.
And we've got to realize that. If I want it for myself, child of me, I want it for everybody.
That's right.
That joy, knowing that I could go out here, die in a car accident, I could drop dead right now. It is like Brother Sonny Hellnaker. He said, that's where I want to die. I want to die on the pulpit. I was like, I don't know about all that, but, you know, if I was to, I know where I'm going. How many people out here? I read a statistic, and I like numbers. But, however, they say 80% of statistics are made up, so you take this for what you think of. There are 7.8 billion people in this world right now. That's a lot of people. In fact, I told you one time when I preached, for every person that's alive, there has been 16 people that's come and gone, lived their life. They think that there's been over 108 billion people that's ever lived. But right now, there's 7.8 billion people. So when, as you go throughout your day today, you know, you have your salvation. Say a prayer for somebody that you don't. You know, the waitress that serves you at Cracker Barrel. Say a prayer for her salvation. Because prayer works.
Yeah, it does. Mm-hmm.
Because, see, there was a time that I was a rank sinner. And now, I'm an associate pastor. And that's to God's glory.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Because he can take me that far in such a short time. You know, the other day we were talking about how, you know, we could get up here and speak for 25, 35, 40 minutes. And he could save this entire church. It's just a few.
That's right.
Because he is who he is.
Yep.
He's God. Sovereign God. In control of it all. And because he has extended me the gift of salvation, we need to be extending that to these 7.8 billion people. There's roughly what? 45, 50 people in here today? That's just a small, I mean, I got that's even like a millionth of a percent of the world's population. God commissioned all of us. Not just pastors, not just Sunday school, not just worship leaders, not just choir members. All of us, because you have an experience. You have your own reasons for coming to God. And it's about time we start sharing. You know, and I've probably shared this before, but I'm going to share it again. For almost a year before I started coming to this church, Christy was coming. And every evening, you know, when it was time to come back, go to church, oh no, that's okay, honey. You've got dishes that are sitting there. I'll stay here and wash them. You got laundry to do, I'll stay here and wash them. But then he said, you know what? You have two children. You have two sons. And he said, if they die not knowing who I am, I ain't blaming them. I'm blaming you. I was like, wow, that's a pretty good reason. I'll be at church next Sunday. And ever since then. I mean, even when I wasn't serving the church, Even when I was just a member, the sweeter and sweeter he grew. One of the amazing things, I've been to the National Cathedral in Washington, D.C. Packed, side by side, elbow to elbow. And I have never felt the love of God like I did when I come through that door. And that's to your credit, because you're his children. See, that's the thing. We've got to understand that as his children, we need to be showing the same properties, like these, like I said earlier, the Beatitudes. If you're meek, you'll be blessed. If you're a peacemaker, you'll be blessed. And it's not a matter of doing things to get something out of it. It's a matter of being one of his and kind of doing what you can to return that love. Jesus reconciled us to God with his Spirit alive in our hearts, makes us a Christian. And I read a quote, and I can't remember who said it, but they quoted and they said, Christianity is more than humanity. Mm-hmm. And I'm going to be saying that for quite some time, because we've got to be more than just what we once were. Yep. I'm not going to say those people, because I was once one of those people. But because now I'm a Christian, I've got to be more. And I've got to do more. And I've got to, you know, there's times when I'm speaking and I'm like, where'd that come from? Of course, I know it was the Holy Spirit, but I was like, I didn't know that. And see, that's the good thing about being a Christian, is you open your mouth and witness or testimony, and the Holy Spirit will give you the words.
Yeah, they will.
Isn't that amazing?
It is.
I mean, just for that fact right there, we should be praising him. See, through his death, Jesus put us in a position to seek peace with God. And because we have that peace, we need to be introducing people to the Prince of Peace. Hey, here's my Jesus. I want you to make him your Jesus. But see, as we're doing that, we can't be hypocritical. We can't have a holier than thou attitude. And we definitely better not be taking God's judgment from him.
That's right.
Yeah. We're not to judge anybody. And that's the thing is, you know, that's why a lot of people don't come to church. Just like in the Sunday school lesson last Sunday. Well, I ain't going to that church. It's full of hypocrites. Well, if you know somebody that says that, then maybe you need to be showing them a different side of our church. Maybe you need to be saying, hey, we're not hypocrites. It's like a t-shirt. I like t-shirts from where I went to all the youth quests and accelerants and everything like that. But the shirt has a picture of a cross on it. It says, I'm not perfect. I'm just forgiven. Mm-hmm. And that's what we've got to be showing people. We're not perfect people. We're not ever going to be perfect on this side of our life. The only time we'll ever attain perfection is when we go home. And we've got to be sharing that with people. See, Jesus was moved with compassion for us because we were in our human condition. And that condition is we were guilty in our sin and staying with it. And as much as he has forgiven, each and every one of you know some things about yourself that you would be ashamed if somebody else found out. And yet, he still forgave you for it. So, when we speak to somebody, we can't be, like I said, all judgy about people because, you know what? Because some of the things I've done, I am ashamed of, and I wouldn't want anybody to know. But you know what? He still gave it to me. So whatever this person is that you're talking to, witnessing or testifying to, they've got the same thing. And we've got to let them understand that as much as we had it in our lives, and God still forgave us for it, the exact same thing can happen for them. We've got to seek out peace for them. Jesus said, while I was hanging on the cross, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Amen. These people out here, and you know what? They think, okay, as long as I'm not hurting anybody, it's fine. I can do what I want, how I want, when I want, where I want. But we've got to let them know that, yes, you may not be hurting your fellow person or your neighbor, but you're hurting yourself. And we've got to realize that if we've been saved from that condition, shouldn't we want that for our neighbor? And for those that aren't our neighbor, just like I said, on the for those that we don't like, for those that cuss us, that think that we're hypocritical, for those that like, well, that John Cooper, I just, you know, something about him irks me. If that's the case, forgive me for doing it. I didn't know what I did to irk you, but that's what we need to do. We need to show them that no matter how bad you treat me, I'm going to love you. Because that's what God did for us. See, whether somebody likes us or not, and, you know, it's really something for us to worry about that. I mean, because we all have, it's like me and Christy. I'm a nerd. I'm a geek. I like Star Wars and stuff like that. And I have friends that like that too. And last night I was watching, I wasn't really watching it, I was just, I had it on. But there was a Star Wars TV show, and she's like, oh my goodness, look at what you've got on TV. And I was like, but, you know, it's just me. It's what I like. I mean, I was 5 years old when it came out, so it was just right. But the thing about what we need to do is whether somebody may not like us or not, we have to realize in these next set of verses that we still have a promise. In Matthew 5, verses 43 through 48, listen to these words. You've heard it said that you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I say to you, love your enemies. Bless those who curse you. Do good to those who hate you. And pray for those who spitefully use you or persecute you. Amen. That you may be sons of your Father in heaven. See, there it goes back to being a child of God. For he makes the sun rise on the evil and on the good, and sends the rain on the just and the unjust. For if you love those who love you, what reward have you? Do not even the tax collectors do the same? And if you greet your brethren only, what do you do more than others? Do not even the tax collectors do so? Therefore, you shall be perfect just as your Father in heaven is perfect. See, this is both a promise and a warning, telling us that, hey, that's what the people out there are doing. If you're my children, you best step up your game. Because how are we going to get to this world, Charlie, if we're not showing them something more extraordinary than what they get out there?
That's right.
How are they going to know that a God created them and then sent his son to die for their sins if we don't tell them? You look around. Everybody has an elbow room this morning. In the condition of the world today, this should be a packed house. But they don't see that. Well, it's Sunday. Sunday's a day to sleep in. And I say that because I used to sleep in on Sunday mornings. But you know what? As much as I love seeing each and every one of you, I'm not here for you. I'm here for my Savior.
Yep.
I'm here to be in corporate worship. Just as the song said, we worship and adore you, Jesus. That's why we were created. And if we were created to do that, we best start doing it. Even when we don't feel like it. Even when, oh, well, I got a cold today, so I'll just stay at home and not go to church. Forgive the terminology, but suck it up, let it cut, and go anyway. Because that's what the people of this world do. They make it about them. And I don't know about you, but there's nothing good in me other than the Holy Spirit of the living God living in my life that I can claim anything good in this life.
That's right.
Amen.
All right, so just as another, let's say, exercise, close your eyes. And I want you to think of all the potential people that may have said a prayer for your salvation.
Amen.
How many people can you just think right offhand? You got 5, maybe 10, 15, 20? So if, all right, let's go with a nice round number, 25 people. If 25 people prayed, all it, you know, whether it was all at once or whether it was just, you know, individually, that's 25 people. Now imagine if we, as a church, turn around and pray for the salvation of 25 more people, and then those 25 pray for more 25 people. Just imagine how quickly our family could grow if we do what he's asked us to do, to be peacemakers. I don't know about you, but I thank God for those people that prayed for me.
Amen.
And you know what? I don't know where I read this. It may have been in one of those books like 23 Minutes in Heaven or whatever. But in it, he said, when he went to heaven, everybody that ever had a part in his Christian walk that had gone and passed away, he met them in heaven. So when this book tells me, this Bible tells me that when one person comes to salvation, heaven rejoices. We need to start rejoicing. We need to get to the point to where we're showing people this is what we need to do. And the day that he calls us all home, imagine the rejoicing, the marriage supper of the Lamb. Marie, you got your invitation? I got mine. And I want it for so many more people. As I look upon you, only you and God knows whether you're saved or not. I don't have that gift. I don't have that ability. But it's up to you. You're responsible. You know, Paul said, work out your own salvation. But it doesn't stop there. If we are his children, we best be saying, hey, you know Jesus? You know Jesus? You know Jesus? Okay, you may know about him, but is it your Savior? Were you saying that I don't know what that person may think of me when we're testifying or witnessing? Does it really matter? Because in Isaiah 54 and 17, and I promise I'm hurrying. No weapon formed against you shall prosper. Just as we sang in the song, every tongue which rises against you in judgment, you shall condemn. This is your heritage of the servants of the Lord. If we're serving God, that means us. This is what he will protect us from. And their righteousness is from me, says the Lord. So he's got our back coming and going. He has saved us. We get the blessing for being a peacemaker. We get the blessing for being chewed out for being a peacemaker. It doesn't matter. We win in the end. It's all about just doing what he's asked us to do, to be obedient to that Holy Spirit tugging in our heart. And it bears a promise of whether they like you or not. You see, whether they think you're genuinely concerned or a judgy Christian, it doesn't matter. Because Jesus is the Savior, and we must decide whether or not to, like I said, to be obedient to the Spirit moving upon us to be a part of somebody's salvation. Imagine the relief you felt. When I got up from here, when I accepted salvation, it was like I felt so light and so airy. Man, I think I could have flown out these doors because I accepted finally. You know, like Pastor Mike says, there's a difference from being head saved, and I was head saved many times. But the time that it took, and it actually, he came into my heart and said, well, we can't have this, and he started moving things around. Man, what a wonderful day. Left here, the grass was greener, the sky was bluer, the clouds were whiter. And I want that for as many people as I can come across. You know, I go through Walmart sometimes. Don't know their situation, but, you know, Lord, just touch them. Move in their situation. You know, if they're Christian, great, God bless them. But move in their situation so they can be encouraged and being emboldened by the Holy Spirit to do more for him. Would we want to be so selfish that, okay, I got my salvation, Y'all, worry about yourself. If Jesus was filled with compassion in our condition, and we've come out of that condition, shouldn't we be just as compassionate for those that haven't? See, if we're to do that, somebody that you don't like, or somebody that doesn't like you, guess what? They're going to start loving you. So your enemy is no longer your enemy, but a fellow brother and sister. Now, I don't know about you, but I like family reunions, seeing people I haven't seen in a while. Oh, I've never seen that person. Well, come on in, you know, get what you want. That's what we need to be doing. One last verse and another promise. 2 Corinthians. Chapter 13, verse 11. Finally, brethren, farewell. Become complete. Be of good comfort and one mind. Live in peace. And here's your promise. The God of love and peace will be with you. How many people can say that? How many people want that? I do. Because see, I told you time and time again, it's not that I need God every day. I need Him more than every hour. I need Him moment to moment. Because see, I preached about this one time. In an average person's life, you think anywhere from 20-some thousand to 70,000 thoughts a day. I don't know the math, but that's quite a few thoughts running through your head. But to know that God has promised to be with me all throughout my day, even to the end of my life, and forever in heaven. Wow. Am I the only one excited about that? Because, I mean, that's what we should be doing. Praise you, Father. Praise you, Jesus.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you for what you've done. And it's not even about what you've done. It's about who you are. I'll share this one last thing. On Spirit FM, there's a group called Need to Breathe. And the song is said, "Who Am I?" Man, when that song comes on, I have it on CD. While you go to Max. And, you know, of course, Hunter's like, that's why you can't hear anything. But that's okay. I'm going to sing to God the way I want to sing to God. Who am I that you would love me so much? Even when I push you away, God, you still hold my hand. Who am I that you love me that much? On my barren soul, He grows roses. Like today. Today, this ain't me. This is all Him. He's teaching me this lesson as I am teaching it to you. Who am I to be loved by you? Who am I that the God of love and peace wants to be with me? Hallelujah. Would you stand, Joel? Let's go to God. Let's encourage Him. Not that He needs it, But let's encourage him to make us peacemakers. Let's have the Holy Spirit. Let's pray to the Holy Spirit saying, hey, you know what? There's people that out there that needs the peace that we have. Show me who they are. Give me the encouragement and the boldness to speak to them, to show them there's a better way to live. It's the only way to live. Because, I mean, if you think about the alternative, an eternity in torment, yes, thank you, Lord. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord. Thank you for your Holy Spirit speaking to our hearts. Lord, thank you for, like I said, you just being who you are, you being you. We thank you, Lord, that we can come to you, that you're as close as saying your name. You said that you would be closer than any brother that we could have. You said, you promised. So, Lord, let your church stand on your promises. Let your church be your hands and feet. Let your church be peacekeepers. Not because we get blessed by it, but because we just want to return to love. Just as as our mothers and fathers here on earth love us and we want to love them back. Lord, we want to love you back. We want to fulfill our purpose of worshiping and adoring you. We thank you, Lord. It's all for your glory. It's all for your honor. And it's all for your praise. Now, Father, as we go out into this world, we ask for your protection, your leading, and your guiding. Because it's all about you, Jesus.
Amen.
And we pray. We'll give you glory, the honor, and praise for all. In your Son's Jesus' name we pray. And all is said.
Amen. Amen.